like you, reaching people for the Lord, he's going to try to take them down. And that's exactly what he did in your life. But you're an overcomer.
Sure. Sure. By
After
faith.
How many years?
We have overcome by faith.
Faith. The word
overcome
of our testimony.
By faith.
Yeah, by
and,
faith.
And, you know, this book details not only tragic experiences that I went through, but the message is God cares about us.
Yeah.
He loves us. And we have a purpose. No matter where you are according to the season of life, no matter what you're going through, no matter what you've been through, you have purpose. And if you have a purpose, then that means there's a road out of whatever it is mm-hmm. that you're going through and dealing with. So have faith in God. Have faith in God right now. And that faith that you have been given, and you don't need to have somebody pray a special prayer over you for you to receive faith. The Bible says that everybody has been given a measure of faith. In other words, everybody has the ability to believe. So that means you have enough faith to believe on the Lord Jesus and be saved. And then if you're a Christian, you have enough faith to endure and to persevere whatever it is that you're dealing with right now. And this gift of faith is so real. And through the experiences that I faced in my life, the Holy Spirit has revealed to me over and over and over and over again that by faith, through faith, we can endure, we can overcome. And through all of the tragedies, you know, I went through about 14 years of being buffeted and overwhelming circumstances, first death, then divorce, then the devastation of losing everything. And I went from what some people would call a successful ministry, preaching in some of the great churches across America and around the world, to living out of my car for some time. But I lost everything. I lost my home. I lost my support because of the, you know, what great preacher was it that said, whenever you find yourself in the desert, the carnivorous creatures always collect to criticize. So through the aftermath of these initial things that I went through, it was devastating to my ministry. And so the booking stopped and the support stopped. And I went from quite a bit of support to almost no support. And so for a season, I was living in and out of my car, living in and out of hotel rooms, and staying with friends and sisters and people who were kind enough to minister to me through that time. But it went from one thing to another, was buffeted one thing to another, the loss of that, and then surviving from day to day until 2009, when on a mission field I suffered what the doctor officially called complete exhaustion. And my doctor literally told me that I was about a year away from death. He said, if you don't change some things, if you don't take care of some things, he said, you'll be dead and gone in a year's time. And I had lost from about 200 pounds down to about 162 pounds and was just barely surviving on a mission field, trying to do a work for God, trying to survive, and I collapsed one afternoon after preaching three times. I don't do that anymore. I preach one time a day now. But I've learned how to slow down just a little bit. And 10 months after that, in 2010, very weak, very thin, dealing with anemia, coming out of what the doctor called complete exhaustion, I was attacked in Ecuador. I was held at gunpoint. I was beaten with the gun. I was stabbed several times.
My, oh my.
And I'm in the back of a taxi. And, you know, that should have been, as far as the devil is concerned, the end of my story. Something very powerful happened to me in the hospital early that next morning in Quito, Ecuador. Laying in the hospital bed, coming in and out of consciousness, I'd suffered a concussion. I'd lost a lot of blood the night before, and I woke up sort of in a daze, and there was a doctor on this side working on me, and there was a nurse over on this side, and I had been stabbed inside my ear. I'd been stabbed up over my ear, and so that's where I lost most of the blood. Both of my hands had been stabbed. I could see the bone. You can see the scar there now in that hand. I could see my bone in this hand. This hand had been stabbed all the way through. And so nurse is working over here, and I passed back out. And then when I woke up again, I realized that I was singing. Only I could do this, but I woke myself up singing in the hospital, and I stopped, you know, immediately because the nurse is just a few inches away from my face, and I remember her saying, "Hermoso, señor," you know, beautiful. Señor. And I was singing to the top of my lungs in my dream, and obviously I was doing it while I was unconscious. I was singing, living by faith in Jesus above, trusting, confiding in His great love, from all harm safe in His sheltering arms. I'm living by faith, and I feel no alarm. That was a powerful revelation to me. Yeah. I should have left Ecuador wanting to quit ministry at that point. I mean, after all the devastating things that I'd been through, now I just went to the mission field to please the Lord and to serve the Lord and to live my purpose. And I had spent every dime that I had
to get
to the mission field, put everything in it. And I said, "Lord, I'm not much. I can't do very much. It looks like it's over for me as far as ministry is concerned. But I want to use the rest of my life to serve you anywhere that you want me to go." And, you know, my heart broke for the country of Ecuador, and the door opened, and I went down there, and I was nearly killed. And after that horrible event, I should have said, "You know what? That's it for me. I'm out of here. I'm not the martyr type, you know. I read about great martyrs and their great faith. I'm just not one of these people." But there I was. And the Lord gave me a beautiful revelation in the hospital bed in Quito, Ecuador. "I'm not finished with you. This is not the ending of your story. This is just a comma in your story. I'm not putting a period here in Ecuador. There's a comma. I have a purpose and a plan for you." And there was a strength that rushed through my spirit. And I left Ecuador. Sure, I was struggling. I came back to the States only to lose my home for the second time. My support dried up. And again, the carnivorous creatures collected to criticize. You know, I don't understand why people do things like that. And it seemed hopeless for me. The doors began to close. And there I was, facing the aftermath of another horrible storm. But I had a resurgence of a strength like I'd never had before in my entire life.
Yeah, you should have been dead.
And I rose up from that with a greater determination and a greater desire to very simply live my purpose. And I realize something now that a lot of people need to realize who are facing great storms. This is not God doing this to you. Mm-mm. God's not making you sick. It's not God who's taken all your money away from you. Mm-mm. But God can use these circumstances for the greater good. Romans 8:28 is in effect in my life and in your life right now. All things work together for good. All things work together for the good. Think about this. You're chosen by God. He loves you. He cares about you. He has a purpose for your life. And so no matter how hot the furnace gets or how great the battle is, hold on to this gift of faith that He has given to all of us and persevere. Keep fighting. Keep going on. Keep standing by faith, and victory will come. And then victory will come. And then victory will come. He takes us from victory to victory, victory to victory. And, you know, this story is filled with tragic testimonies and devastating stories. It's a part of the story or the testimony of my life. But one thing that will be clear to any reader of this book is that with every storm, there is a victory. With every trial, there is a breakthrough. Many years ago, you know, my dad was a great songwriter. He's mm-hmm. written a lot of the great gospel hits since, I guess, the 1950s. But one song he wrote has been on my mind for the past several days. There will be a million smiles for every tear that falls.
Wow.
And sure, I've been through some discouragement, been through some tears, been through some hard times, but I've seen some great miracles. I lost some friends, I lost some supporters, and I lost some people that I thought would be with me for the rest of my life. But I also gained some amazing friends. And the Lord brought angelic visitors to my aid. And there's details in this book about ministers of the gospel who came to my aid during these dark times. One of the great pastors in my life is a man by the name of David Vinoy. You'll read his name many times throughout my book. Another great messenger of hope in my life was a former general overseer of the Church of God and a former president of Lee College, which is Lee University now, and former president of the Pentecostal Fellowship of North America, a man by the name of Ray H. Hughes. You'll find his name throughout that book. And he was a tremendous messenger of hope and healing and deliverance
in
my life.
That's what we need to be.
And that's what I want to be right now. That's what I've dedicated my life to right now as an adjunct professor and as a pastor of a small local church. I want to be a messenger of hope to people. You know, we're living in a day of hurt. It's a day of darkness for a lot of people. These are the last days. And there is a spirit of discouragement that mm-hmm. has settled upon the entire world. And it's, you know, it's very clear that people are living overwhelmed by that darkness that shrouded
yes.
this world. They've opened themselves to the darkness
of
this world.
Not faith, but fear.
They're living in complete discouragement,
yeah.
overwhelming fear.
And without faith, it's impossible to please God. Fear attracts just like faith attracts. I want to do something a little special, different. We never do this, but I would like you to go ahead and get this book. It's tragedy after tragedy after tragedy, but then he gives you the answers of how he's come out of it.